Hey there, how's it going, kiddo? Did you have a good day at school? Yeah. What was the best part of your day? Nice. Nice, yeah. Yeah, it was a lot of very fond memories of hanging out with my friends and exploring and building tree forts and all kinds of stuff. I'm glad you're able to recreate some of that in your own way. I'm sure it's different. And someday you'll be hopefully talking to your own child and telling them about what it was like when you were a kid and how it was different. I wonder how those conversations are gonna go, huh? I think chapter 4, right? I think we left off on chapter 4. let's see here. Let's see. Jeremy's run. Book 1, Early Dark, chapter 4. Okay. Buckle up. Alright. The rumble, very faint at first, gathered strength, so deep and low it lay somewhere between hearing and feeling. "Is that what I think it is?" Jeremy asked. "Hard to say," Matt replied, scanning the sky. "But I don't think so. Did anybody see a flash?" Jeremy asked if it might have been too far away. "We'd have seen it," Matt replied. "Just like with lightning, you see the flash a lot farther than you can hear the sound." The sound morphed into a series of low and distant booms. Matt said he didn't think it was a nuke. "Whatever it is," Jeremy replied, "it's big." The cavernous booming slowly faded. Someone shouted in a nearby street. There came a taunting response. They listened to the altercation, several people involved in it by the sound of it. "What are they fighting about?" Sarah asked. "What do people always fight about?" Jeremy replied. It ended quickly with a barrage of insults hurled back and forth. Jeremy checked his watch. "It's 11:45. "Your watch works?" Kate asked Jeremy. Jeremy examined it under the red setting of his headlamp. "It's working." He glanced at Matt. "Small chip?" "Yep." "You think the whole country is down?" "There's a finite possibility that I could be wrong," Matt said. "But I'd bet money this is coast to coast." Another explosion boomed in the distance to the southeast. "That sounded like another jet," Jeremy observed. Matt snorted with a head shake. "You've got to believe they had some warning of all of this. Why the hell didn't they call a ground stop 2 hours ago? Frickin' idiots." "All those people," Sarah said. "Yeah," Matt said. His tone was grim. "All those people." "I don't want this to sound wrong," Jeremy said, "but if there's no power nationwide, and if it's out for months, the people on those planes might be the lucky ones." No one argued the point. "Listen," Kate said. Sarah shivered despite the mild night.
"What?"
"Just listen." No sounds reached them from Lincoln Boulevard, which ran along the east side of the complex beyond the towers. They heard nothing beyond the sporadic chatter of neighboring residents speaking in hushed tones. The night continued to have a strange feel about it. After a long pause, Sarah said she didn't hear anything. She asked Cade what he was hearing.
"Same as you," he replied.
"What's your point?" Karina asked. Cade asked what they were not hearing. Someone laughed abrasively from across the courtyard.
"I heard that," Karina said.
"His point," Jeremy said. "It's that we've got a sunset with no sun." When no one responded, Jeremy added, "We've got no power.
We've got bumper cars on Lincoln, a nuclear explosion, planes falling out of the sky, gunfire in the streets. And what are we now, and what are we hearing in response to all that? No ambulances? Karina said. Exactly. Nada. Nothing. No cops, no fireworks, no helicopters. Nothing, Jeremy replied. I mean, it's like there's nobody out there. Then you know what that means, Cade said. Chaos, Jeremy replied. Total anarchy. He trailed off. I don't even know what that looks like, but I've got a feeling we're going to find out. Matt allowed that such might be a possibility, but he thought most people would be reasonable, at least for a couple of days, until desperation set in. It won't take 2 days, Cade countered. This place is going to get looted to the ground. Jeremy said they needed a plan. Karina fished in her jeans and came up with another joint. I've got a plan. She passed it to Jeremy. Here you go. Toke up, sweetie. He thanked her and pocketed it. Hey, you're not going to smoke that? No. Then give it back. No. Give it back. You can't. Hey, Jeremy replied, pushing her hand away from his pocket. We're done with that. Yeah? Says who? You can't. Enjoy your high. It'll be your last one for a while. Karina turned to Cade. He can't do that. I think he just did, Cade said in a mild tone. You better listen to the man. Karina cursed. There came a long, breathless moan from somewhere across the courtyard. Well, Karina said, at least she's having a good time. The problem, Jeremy said, addressing Cade and Matt, is that we're not ready for this. I don't know how many times my dad warned me about something like this. Damn, I never took him seriously. At least, not seriously enough. Matt scowled. Jay, if you took every maybe it could happen scenario seriously, you'd do nothing but hoard food and live in a damn cave. Yeah, well, maybe. I still think a little prep would have gone a long way, but it is what it is. It is what it is. Matt said with a touch of whimsy. I hate that expression. I mean, it's stupid, it's fatalistic. I guess we might as well go suck our toes because, you know, it is what it is. Not for me, Jeremy replied. For me, it's the starting point for escaping your mental prison. Escaping your so-called mental prison would be like a fishing... Sorry. Escaping your so-called mental prison would be like a fish escaping the water it lives in. It can't be done. Oh, Jeremy replied. So you agree? It is what it is. Jesus, Matt shook his head. I guess we all just give up now, is that it? Not at all, Jeremy replied. It means you look reality in the eye and accept it. You don't waste time bitching about it. You focus on what you can do going forward. It opens up all kinds of possibilities. Weren't you the one who said we're screwed? Cade asked Matt. What I meant was, it's going to get really difficult in ways we can't even imagine. That may be, Jeremy said, but what difference does it make? The relevant question is, how do we get the jump on the situation? Given we're talking no cops, what do we do right now? What should be our top three priorities? I was thinking the same thing, Cade replied. What are you saying? Matt asked, dropping to nearly a whisper. You want to join the looters? Cade and Jeremy looked at him, their faces vague shapes in the gloom. Okay, Matt said and held up his hands. All right, just wanted to be sure I was hearing you. Are you pretty sure we're screwed? Jeremy asked Matt. Do you think? Matt replied. Guys, not to be melodramatic, but seriously, the more I think about it... He gazed into the courtyard and heaved a sigh. For all intents and purposes, the world we knew yesterday? It's gone.
It's gone and it's not coming back. Not in our lifetimes. And I mean, even if we lived old age, which we won't.
Sweetie, Karina said, you might be pretty smart.
Okay, you're really smart. But on this one, sorry, babe, you're totally full of it.
Well, baby, Matt replied, mirroring her breezy affect, on this one, we all better hope you're right, and I'm totally 100% wrong.
You are, she replied. Just wait and see.
Jeremy suggested that whether or not Matt was correct, they should plan as if he was. Cade and Sarah agreed. Karina, who seemed to be drifting in and out, didn't respond. Jeremy asked Sarah what she thought about them doing a little midnight shopping. The shopping didn't bother her. The idea of competing with other, possibly armed and desperate people did.
You know, what's weird about this whole deal, Jeremy said, is that until the nuke lit up the towers, we never heard or saw any explosions. I mean, no warning, nothing.
They were in space, Sarah replied.
In space?
That's what I was reading on my phones before it quit.
She's right, Matt said. It's techno-dweeb shit, but she's right. You detonate nukes above the atmosphere. It must have been a hell of a pulse. Then we got that second lick from the air blast. That was a 1-2 punch. This place got zapped to the max, and we know it's nationwide.
How do we know that? Jeremy asked.
Matt Weather. They don't go there unless they can't function out of D.C., so yeah, this is national, and therefore probably global, or will be before it's over.
Global, Jeremy said.
Matt issued a derisive sniff.
You don't think we leave Europe or Asia intact if we're down and vulnerable, do you?
In case you failed to notice, we don't play very nice with the other kids.
I don't suppose, Jeremy replied, there's any chance we could work out a deal where they help us in exchange for not nuking them?
I don't know. Too many variables. Who can you trust other than somebody you can nuke if they double-cross you?
Don't they have backup generators? Cade said.
You would think a city like this would have backup generators up the ass, like especially at hospitals.
A city like this? Matt scoffed.
This city can't find its ass with both hands.
Plus, whatever generators they've got out there use programmable logic controllers, microprocessors, digital displays, digital voltage regulators, all kinds of sensors. I doubt that stuff will work.
So no generators? Jeremy asked.
Matt shrugged. Nothing that's over 20 kilowatts or so, which means the hospitals probably won't even have backup power.
Cade shook his head.
Unbelievable.
Plus, Matt added, we got most of our power from the other states.
He paused.
I guess that tells us something. If the whole city's out, there must be a lot of stuff a long way around us. We buy power from as far away as Montana.
They must have some backups, Cade said. Somebody must have thought about this and taken some precautions. Don't the power companies have to do that?
Plenty of people thought about it, Matt said, but that's about all. Nobody required the power companies to harden their facilities. I read a study a few years ago. It wouldn't have been that expensive to harden the grid compared to, say, keeping the troops in Afghanistan for 6 months, but the Washington wankers didn't bother.
I'll say one thing, Karina said. You've got a good imagination. There's no way they'd let things get out of control like that.
Really? And what do you call this, sweetheart? What do you think is in control of this cluster?
Come on, guys, Jeremy said. There's no point in arguing about it right now.
He stared to the east.
That's weird. What's that light in the sky?
All eyes went to the sky.
Where? Karina said.
Over the towers.
The moon's coming up, Matt replied.
They watched the moon in its last quarter slowly emerge from one of the angled penthouse towers. A ragged low cloud intervened, silvered at the edges.
I've got a problem, Cade said.
Jeremy glanced at him. I was wondering when you'd say something, Cabrina. Yeah, where is she?
With her folks. She went down to San Diego for the weekend. He turned to Matt. How do I get through to her?
You don't. The moon emerged from the cloud and Cade studied him in the tenuous light. There's always a way.
Not always, Matt said quietly. I'm sorry, man, but everything will be out. Phones, towers, microwave relays. Even if we had a couple of ham operators who happened to have shielded their equipment, how would we find them?
An awkward silence ensued. I'm sorry, Sarah said.
Maybe we head down there, Jeremy offered.
No. They could see Cade's tears in the darkness. He wiped a cheek with his sleeve.
Jeremy persisted. We might make it. I mean, you're the one guy here with military experience.
Forget it. He said something in Spanish and added, she might as well be on the moon.
You know where she is, Jeremy replied. I'm serious.
Cade nodded. I appreciate it, Jay. I really do.
The thing is, even if we somehow make it down there, we might not even find her. It's the wrong move.
So what's the right move? Matt asked.
Cade again wiped his eyes. I never should have let her go.
Hey, don't go there, Jeremy said. No way you could know.
I know, but don't go there, bro. There's no upside.
Cade wiped his eye with the heel of his hand.
It's weird, isn't it? You think life's just going to keep going. One minute everything's fine, and then the next.
Jeremy nodded. Yeah, one minute it's sunny and lovely, and the next. And there's not one damn thing you can do about it.
There are some things we can do, Matt replied.
Jeremy glanced at him.
We're listening. We can find a plane and get the hell out of here.
No one said anything. Finally, Jeremy said, go on.
I'm positive there are still planes that run, just like there'll be a few cars and trucks that still run. Old school stuff.
You're serious, Cade said.
Dead serious. The trick will be to find one, but if we did...
We could fly anywhere, Karina said.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't say anywhere, but yeah, we could find the right bird. We could get the hell out of Dodge.
You'd fly out of LAX? Jeremy asked.
No way. I'd start with my home field.
Ah, Jeremy said. Santa Monica.
Correct. Odds?
No idea, but that might be our best shot.
What about the marina? Cade said. Could we sail out of here?
You got any experience sailing? Jeremy asked him.
No, but you do.
Well, not really. I mean, I crewed on a 35-footer, but I was just a deckhand. I'm not a sailor.
That would limit our options, Matt added. We have a lot more options with a plane, and it'll be a whole lot faster. I assume you guys realize that if we're right and the whole grid is down, we're in about the worst place we could possibly be.
Tell me about it, Cade said. Whatever we do, we definitely need to get the hell out of here, and we need to move fast.
Why? Karina said. This is my town.
Not anymore, it isn't, Cade said. You know what this city turns into when the lights go out, and no cops, no cars, no radios?
I should have listened to my dad, Jeremy said.
He sent me an email 2 days ago. He was really worried. He wanted us to head up to St. George and pick up my sister in Vegas.
He smiled. I doubt Jackie would have come. She's pretty independent. I hope she's okay.
Cade asked how far it was to St. George.
Almost like 400 miles, Jeremy replied.
It's right on the Arizona-Utah border on the 15. I've driven it a lot. If we go there, we'll definitely need to fly.
You have to cross most of the IE, he said, referring to the Inland Empire. Practically all the way to San Bernardino, then you take the 15 up to Victorville and Barstow, and then it's really serious desert all the way to Vegas.
Vegas is serious desert, Matt said. I mean, true, but you know what I mean. Nothing even grows out there, and it's more serious desert from Vegas up to St. George.
Isn't St. George in the desert? Matt asked.
It's dry, Jeremy admitted, but the Virgin River flows right through it, and it runs year-round.
Sarah suggested that San Diego was a lot closer.
We'd have the same problem there as we've got here, Kate replied. Or worse.
But Cabrini's there.
Cade bit his lip.
It's too risky. I can't ask you guys to do that.
Jeremy chuckled.
What?
We just watched a damn nuclear explosion. A jet practically fell on our house.
And you think San Diego's too risky?
I'm just saying.
I know, Jeremy replied. The longer we're in a densely populated area, the worse our odds. That's what you're going to say, right?
Something like that.
Maybe I head down there, Cade said. You guys could find a plane and get to Utah.
Jeremy was adamant.
We're not splitting up.
Jay, I can't. If you go, we all go. We get through this together, or we don't get through it at all. Come on, man.
You know that better than any of us.
Sarah stepped over to Cade and gave him a hug, which surprised him.
He thanked her.
I thought you didn't feel empathy.
I don't, but I know when someone needs a hug.
She hugged him again and he returned it.
He smiled, sadness in it, and gazed out into the courtyard.
I feel so helpless. Why did she have to pick this weekend?
The thing is, Jeremy said, if we could fly in and fly out,
if we fly somewhere, Matt said, it's doubtful we'll fly out. We get a plane, it's a one-way ticket to wherever we're headed.
Jeremy said, they'll keep the plane.
A working aircraft will be like one of the most valuable commodities around.
We should have gone to Utah, Sarah said, I like your parents, they're nice. And they're preparing for something like this.
Jeremy gave her a squeeze.
You're right, hon. Like Matt said, if we went up to Utah every time my dad was worried, we'd have been living there.
But you're right. We should have gone this time.
Sarah shifted from one foot to the other.
I need to go to the bathroom, number one.
Jeremy said he could take a leak himself.
Me too, Matt said. But we're doing it in the bushes. We can't afford another toilet flush.
You're assuming we don't have water, Jeremy?
I'm sorry. You're assuming we don't have water, Jeremy said.
If we do, Matt said, we better fill the sinks and tubs.
I don't think it's working, Karina said. They waited for her to continue. When she didn't, Jeremy pointed out that they heard the toilet flush.
It did, but it didn't make any noise after, you know, like it usually does.
Shit, Matt replied. Why didn't you say anything?
Well, nobody... We better check it out.
They filed into the kitchen. Jeremy illuminated
the area with a small LED flashlight placed on the counter aimed at the ceiling. He approached the sink.
The group hovered above the island where Jeremy turned on the tap, on one tap, then the other. A few drops dribbled into the basin.
Okay, I guess that answers that.
This is bullshit, Karina said. Why did they turn off the water?
Nobody flushed that toilet in the master, Matt said.
Karina snorted.
Why?
Because we may need the water.
What are you going to do? Drink out of the toilet?
It could come to that.
That's disgusting. You guys can do what you want, but I'm not drinking from a damn toilet.
You might be drinking from worse than that before this is over.
Guys, Jeremy said, knock it off.
Karina persisted.
I just want to know why the stupid water isn't working.
Because the system's already drained, Matt replied. That didn't take long.
What do you mean, drained?
In this area, Matt replied, water pressure comes from water that's being pushed up into a water tower. To do that, you need pumps. To run those, you need power, and a lot of it.
I guess that's the problem with being smart, Karina said.
What's that supposed to mean?
You know too much.
Guys, come on, Jeremy said. The last thing we need is to start fighting with each other.
I'm scared, Sarah said.
That makes five of us, Jeremy replied.
It's okay to be scared. We just can't let it get the best of us.
So what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. We often, or at least I can only speak for myself, but I've often thought about, you know, what would we do, and if there was like a crazy event like that, and I don't know. It's funny how people like to romanticize it. You know, there's people that are like, they're preppers and they have like their bunkers and everything. But I really think the reality is, like, if we ever got stuck in something like that, boy, it would not be fun. I'll tell you that, it would not be fun. So, anyway. Alright, I love you, kiddo. Alright. I love you. Yeah. No, you know, I don't spend any time worrying about a situation like this. I forget who said it, but, you know, the problem with worrying about, like, the end of the world scenarios is that if you're right, you're right, but you're only going to be right once, and it won't matter. So you're better off just enjoying your life. Because up until now, well, I mean, who knows, it may have been like a, you know, crazy thing, you know, 12,000 years ago, whole Younger Dryas impact and all that. But, you know, it's probably not going to happen during your and my lifetime. Probably not. Let's hope not. And if it does, there's really nothing we can do about it, so we might as well just enjoy it. Yeah. Yeah. Might as well just enjoy this crazy ride we're on. Alright. Alright. Sweet dreams, kiddo. I'll see you in the morning. Give me a hug. Love you. Come here. Love you. We'll see you tomorrow.